little wooden boy. Now, who else?
A wooden boy. Look, Kitty, look. It's amazing.
Hello. Remember me? I was that nice little girl in Pollyanna and the terrible twins in the Parent Trap. And this was our house in That Darn Cat. And my name is Hayley Mills. Well, I guess I have matured a little. Well, I'm back at Disney Studios to read for the part of Ailunwy in The Black Cauldron. As it turns out, The Black Cauldron is an animated feature. They don't want all 5'4" of me, they just want my voice. I remember when I was 13 years old, Walt Disney taking me by the hand and giving me a guided tour of the whole animation studio to meet the artists who'd created all those marvelous Disney characters.
Lave in the magic mirror, come from the farthest space.
Hey, look! I made it!
Oh, yeah?
Look! Now he is there!
Someone's head will roll for this! Here!
Kind of wobbly, isn't he?
Bumper.
Well, he is. Aren't ya?
Now I have the chance to take you behind the scenes. To see how some moving lines on a screen can make us laugh and even cry.
Oh, boy. These old wings ain't what they used to be. Big Mama, you better lose a few pounds.
Miss Bailey.
Yes.
Hello, I'm Hayley Mills.
What? Well, I'm Pearl. That's all I'm going to buy, Hayley.
I'm going to be doing this same thing. And
are you
going to
sing my song?
No, I'm not going to sing. I wouldn't dream of singing your song. I'm going to be reading for a voice, and it's the first time I've ever done it, and I must admit, I'm a little nervous.
Stand over there, Hayley, and learn from Bailey. And let me show you how I became an owl.
I was surprised to learn that the voice is recorded before the character is animated. Once Pearl Bailey was chosen for the role of Big Mama in The Fox and the Hound, she worked closely with director Art Stevens.
You know, Pearl, as Big Mama, I feel that the sequence is entirely from your viewpoint.
This is me?
Right.
Big Mama.
Ha! I never thought I'd be an owl.
Pearl makes a strong contribution to the development of the owl's character by making suggestions for music and character motivation.
So we feel possibly a song from you for it. What do you think?
Well, up here, it looks like they're the best of friends. Here, I can see it's even better.
You know, Pearl, these little critters are innocent. They don't have any idea that they're supposed to be enemies.
I see it right here now. This woman looks worried. Or rather, this owl looks worried.
He won't ever change.
I hope you're right, Todd.
Well, you know, I'm looking at this, and this is a fox and a hound, Art, and fox and hounds don't seem to make it. But I tell you what, I'm going to keep way back in my under my feathers that they're going to make it.
Roll a take.
Speed.
AA 505 intro, Pearl.
The best of friends.
having so much fun together. You're not even aware you're such a funny pair. You're the best of friends. Life's a happy game. You could clown around forever. Neither one of you sees your natural boundaries. Life's one happy game. If only the world wouldn't get in the way. If only people would just let you play. They say you're both equal. You're breaking all the rules. They can't understand the magic of your wonderland. When you're the best of friends, sharing all that you discover. When these moments have passed, will that friendship last? Who can say there's a way? Oh, I hope it never ends. 'Cause you're the best of friends.
You smelling?
I'm on the trail of
something. Trail of what?
I don't know yet.
What do you do that for?
We're supposed to do that when we find what we've been tracking.
I'm a fox. My name's Todd. What's your name, kid?
Mine's Copper. I'm a hound dog.
What a conscience. Well, I'll tell you. A conscience is that still, small voice that people won't listen to.
Most of us are familiar with Pinocchio. However, this is how the wooden boy looked when he first arrived at the studio. Although this original concept changed, it was the starting point that inspired the story men and helped the animators to envision Pinocchio. Someone has to be the first person to decide how a character is going to look.
Come on, Copper.
In The Fox and the Hound, the original designs were conceived by Mel Shaw.
I'll first make sketches of the characters the way I see them so that they can be visualized by all the artists the same way. Four-legged animals seem to be difficult to animate. I will make a model such as this, so that the animator can see this character from all angles, and it helps him to draw it and visualize it in animation. Then the next step would be to make sketches for the setting where all of this action is going to take place. I'm trying to build mood and feeling, a warm, summery feeling, and then something that was much more dramatic when the hound was running down the fox. And from this point, the stories themselves are put up on storyboards. Then we bring out the very definite, intricate personalities of the various characters. Observing the situation is Big Mama the Owl, and she's watching this unusual friendship.
Of course, animation wasn't always that sophisticated. The early cartoons were very crude and rough. Really, they were just glorified comic strips. Mickey was done with very simple circles, a circle for the head, a circle for the body, and it was connected with what we call rubber hoses to the legs and arms. And this was called the rubber hose school of animation. Here's the way Goofy looked. Everything was moving like a stretch and a rubber. Take Clarabelle Cow the same way. I had to learn a lot about movement. For instance, I learned early that things that move together at the same time, very stiff. But if you move them in a counter movement, it loosens it up. A very pliable squash and stretch. When you did a laugh, for instance, you had to get that counter movement. So when the shoulders went up, your head went down, you go, ha, ha, ha. Ha! Walt was always trying to make their characters pliable and have weight.
Introducing the Barnyard Nightingale, Madam Bella Cluck.
When she walks out on the stage, Clara Cluck had to walk like she's heavy. And we try to get personality in the way we animated things.
Now, the early animated films had very little acting in them because they were predominantly a series of gags. But still, occasionally you needed to know how a character was feeling for the gag to come off. In one of the first Mickeys, when he was angry and frustrated, the animator wanted to show this by having him clench his teeth and do a little gesture of, darn it. Well, he didn't know how to do it very well at that time. This was the best he could do. We were learning very quickly during that period, although it was by trial and error. In 1931, we made the first version of The Ugly Duckling, and there the acting still was very simple and straightforward. But crude as it was, the audience still felt sorry for the little guy. 7 years later, we made another version of The Ugly Duckling, and by this time, the animators had learned how to make a drawing act. Those silly symphonies were a great place to experiment for all of us, and especially for Walt. He always had something new that he wanted to try. You know, picking the right voice for these characters is awfully important because it pinpoints the specific individual that you're using.
Sure does.
We can know we want a mean villain in a but there are all kinds of mean villains. Once you get the voice, suddenly you have a very specific individual. You know, like Pig-Leg Pete.
So the little lady can take care of herself, no?
Yes!
You know, it takes a long time to find the right voice. Oh, there are a lot of good actors, but they can't all do what you want.
Yeah, it has to create an image in the animator's imagination. So we sure looked everywhere for voice, even into the field of opera. The concept of that cartoon voice changed, though pretty soon. You know, Walt was looking for more believable characters all the time. He wanted characters the audience would feel were sincere. The voices were getting so straight, there was nothing to animate anymore.
Like Cookie Carnival.
Hello there. What's the matter? Why are you so silent?
It's very pleasant voices, sir. Yeah. Good acting. No nice voices, but just no character in them from an animator's standpoint.
Nothing for the animator to get a hold of.
Now, don't be so downhearted. There's no need to cry. You're going to be the Cookie Queen.
You know, when you get the right voice, and you animate to it and develop a character, you can't imagine any other voice being with that. It'd be like changing your voice, yeah, or mine. It makes a different personality out of you.
Oh. Please don't run away. I won't hurt you. I'm awfully sorry. I didn't mean to frighten you. But you don't know what I've been through. I'm so ashamed of the fuss I made.
Oh! Please don't run away. I won't hurt you. I'm awfully sorry. I didn't mean to frighten you. But you don't know what I've been through. I'm so ashamed of the fuss I made.
Whenever I see little children, I do little parts for them like, please don't run away. I won't hurt you.
I'm awfully sorry. I didn't mean to frighten you.
But you don't know what I've been through. And all because I was afraid.
I'm so ashamed of the fuss I made.
What do you do when things go wrong?
Oh, you sing a song.
You know, I still remember almost all the lines. I guess I enjoy it.
My father, Guido Casalotti, was a singing teacher here in Los Angeles at that time. And one day, one of the Walt Disney representatives called his studio and asked if he knew of a little girl who could sing and speak as a child would. And I was listening on the telephone upstairs. It was an extension. I said, Papa, how about me? And I said, Walt Disney was not in the room to hear my audition. What I found out later was that he was behind a screen in the same room but in the back. And he didn't want to see anyone who would be trying out. He felt that he would be very much influenced by their looks.
With a smile and a song, life is just like the bright sunny day. Your cares fade away, and your heart is young.
Without our having any indication of what Walt was really thinking, because I don't believe Walt took many of his employees into that deep a confidence, he was planning to make an animated feature long before those of us who worked for him were aware of it. And one night he gave us 50 cents apiece, which was a lot of money, the equivalent of at least $10 now, to have a nice dinner and to come back to the studio where he related by himself the whole Snow White story. He acted all the parts. He even indicated the songs. He had the characters. Everything in this Snow White picture was completely developed in his own mind. We were all so steamed up, so enthused for this project that it didn't really cross our minds to doubt that it could be done. In other words, if Walt felt that we could do it, we'd damn sight better find a way to do it.
Oh, dear. Oh, was this the children of... Why, your little men!
Dwarfs' names fit their personalities. This pompous-looking individual is Doc, the self-appointed leader of the group. This little fellow is bashful. He's secretly in love with Snow White. This funny face is Sneezy. He has hay fever. Old droopy eyes is called Sleepy, and Happy here with a beaming smile.
Yes, and you must be...
Happy, ma'am. That's me, and this is Dopey. He don't talk none.
You mean he can't talk?
He don't know. He never tried.
Oh, that's too bad.
Oh, you must be grumpy.
None of us knew that Walt was upgrading animation. But when Walt got involved, he saw higher possibilities, and he proved it with Snow White.
What are you, and who are you doing? Who are you, my dear?
Oh, how silly of me. I'm Snow White.
Snow White?
The princess?
Yes.
On the features, the straight voices work quite well.
Everybody knows a dog's best friend is a human.
Oh, come on now, fellas. Boy, you haven't fallen to that old line now, have you?
What the world did I do with that magic wand? I was
magic
sure I...
wand?
That's strange. I always...
Why, then you must be...
Your fairy godmother? Of course.
Well, like Bambi's mother. She was charming and sweet.
Very motherly.
I think I'll call him Bambi.
Bambi. Yep, I guess I'll do all right.
Remember, I've never suffered. He wasn't even in the picture when we started. Remember,
yeah.
They got in all these kids to try out the bunny voices. And the casting director said, see, this is when Bambi fell down. He's just learning to walk. And said, now you say, what's the matter? And you say, what happened? And you say, did the young prince fall down? And you say, is he hurt? And they tried the thing when Peter Bain doing this kid here.
Did the young prince fall down?
What a voice. Get that kid out of here. He can't act.
All the animators thought Peter Bain was the best. So the casting director had to run out and find him somewhere.
Yeah, we saw the character of the one lop ear like this, with old buck teeth.
Yeah.
What's the matter?
What happened?
Did the young prince fall down? Is he hurt?
No, he's all right.
He doesn't walk very good, does he?
Thumper?
Yes, Mama.
What did your father tell you this morning?
If you can't say something nice, don't say nothing at all.
Now, there is a case of a character that was built entirely by the voice.
Yeah, Blue is the same thing. He really didn't have a major part in the picture to begin with, just a little cameo role.
Yeah, he was just an ordinary bear going doobity-doo, doobity-doo.
Yeah, and then Walt says, why don't you get Phil Harris out and try him for the voice? And he looked the script over and he says, gee, I don't know how to be a bear.
Hey, kid, you need help. And old Baloo's gonna learn you to fight like a bear.
It was so warm and spontaneous. That's really what we want in an actor when he gives us the voice. We want him to give us the feeling that he's saying those lines for the first time. It isn't something he's rehearsed.
Now give me a big bear growl. Scare me. Oh, boy.
That's Big Mama.
That's right.
But what fascinates me is how you animators manage to get such human, lifelike expressions on animals, birds.
Well, we usually go back to our own faces for inspiration. We can use these mirrors to get a wide range of expressions. For Big Mama, I used this one.
So you mean you sit beside a mirror all day, make faces at yourself in a mirror?
That's right. In fact, hold that one.
Very difficult to hold that one, you know.
I know. Well, what do you think?
It's very good.
Well, in order to get the best kind of result on the screen, I think that we have found that we have to relate the character that we're interpreting with someone that we've either known personally or we have seen in pictures. In other words, we're looking for personality.
Ah, oh, Figaro. I forgot to open the window.
In Figaro, it was my four-year-old nephew. This little kid was easily annoyed. The little tantrums he'd take. And these are the things that we tried to get into Figaro. Little Tootie, he was another example of drawing a personality from a youngster, and yet here we had an inanimate character.
talk of is fun. Won't you ever grow up little too?
He was a little kid, but he was inanimate. And yet he had all the life in the world.
You won't believe this, dearie.
In working out the character of Paige in Lady and the Tramp, I knew I had to have a little gal that was had been around.
Yeah, I'm way ahead of you.
I wondered what I could do with her, with my limited knowledge of what that kind of a lady should be.
He's a tramp. He's a scoundrel.
I finally decided that I would follow the patterns that were given to me by the gal who wrote the song and who sang it for the picture. And I told Peggy one time, Peggy Lee, I told her that I was constantly watching her walk away from me to see how much her rear section moved back and forth. And I used this in my working out of Peg. She became a real little flirt.
Wish that I could travel his way.
What a dog.
What a dog.
The thing is, with using live action for our reference, you can't let it take over. And it can serve a very, very important part of animation. An example of this would be 101 Dalmatians.
Peter, darling, how are you? Miserable, darling, as usual, perfectly wretched.
I had a marvelous actress by the name of Mary Wicks, who did a pantomime performance for me. She did things that I would not have been able to have invented. And this was funny walks, curious ways of moving. However, there were scenes where, well, I looked at the live action that we had and then decided, just forget it, now you give a performance.
Listen, you idiots.
Yet you always had this as a thing to fall back on, something to look at, something, again, to have had an experience with. And this is what animation is all about anyway, is somehow, out of your own experience, you say, this is the way this character should behave, this is the way they should do something.
See you in 3 weeks. Cheerio. Cheerio, darling.
The outside experiences of an animator, perhaps before he ever came to the studio, reflect an awful lot on how you perform, how you act, how you see. Fred Moore, one of the early animators, was a very young man all of his life. He was like the characters that he drew. He developed Mickey into a character who was able to act and act as a human being. But at this time, he was becoming more and more a little boy in this abstract clothing of Mickey Mouse.
So long. I'll be seeing you. I hope.
Bill Tytler was the complete opposite of, say, Freddie Moore. He brought the volatile acting of a man who had been around the world and so on and had this worldliness of how things behaved. Bill did things of enormous scale, this masterful Devil in Night on Bald Mountain, and I consider one of the masterpieces of animators' draftsmanship and performance.
Most of we animators get awfully involved with our characters, and I think Bill Tytler got involved about as much as anybody I ever knew about. I always remember him way back on Pinocchio when he had the character Stromboli, a very volatile Italian, and he would act out trying to sell himself on the way of doing a scene. You know, he'd act out the scene to a fellow animator and he'd advance on him with all these gestures and everything, and this guy would be backing up, you know, until there was nowhere to go.
Hey, I got it, you! You can't do it!
Quiet!
Shut him up! Before I knock you silly.
I'll get involved the same way, but, you know, in a different way. So, you know, like with Madame Medusa, you become Madame Medusa sometimes, and you act out, not for other people, but I'd act it out for myself, you know, and I'd go through what she's going to do, and when she very tenderly kisses this alligator.
Snoops, you don't have a way with children. You must gain their confidence, make them like you.
Yeah? How do you do that?
You force them to like you, idiot!
I feel that I could animate anything in the world. See, that I'm not limited by my size or my weight or my sex or anything. I can do anything, you know? There's nothing I couldn't do if I had a good piece of material. The prince in Sleeping Beauty was about the most uninteresting and almost to the point of calling it odious task I've ever faced. This prince was really a nothing. Now, Peter Pan, I didn't really enjoy him too much, but he was interesting from his weightless characteristic until I got that all figured out, and then he just became a chore, like almost as bad as the prince. Oh, well, Medusa was a very, very rich and wonderful character to work on and a challenge. One thing we don't have in animation is spontaneity. It's kind of a very objective, almost cold-blooded approach to it. Even though I am involved with the character and feel the personality a great deal, I still have to plan.
High tide or not, that little brat is going to find me that diamond tomorrow, or
she had to do physical, jerky things through that line. So I had to find things for her to do. I dreamed up this idea of taking her eyelashes off. Your result on the screen has to feel natural and feel like it's exactly in the mood that you're supposed to be in. And it should feel spontaneous, and if it doesn't, it's no good, you know?
Of course, you have. But we must try harder, mustn't we?
For most of my animation career, I was lucky enough to work on so-called personality characters, developing, like Jiminy Cricket.
Cricket's the name. Jiminy Cricket.
And the cat and the mice and Cinderella. You know, we did other things besides personality animation. We indulged in a little abstract animation every once in a while. Examples where we deviated from the little cutesy pie bunnies looking out from behind a tree. There were other times where Walt used music and created a kind of an abstraction. The instruments that he brought to life and After You've Gone. And the use of the soundtrack in The Three Caballeros, which is purely an abstraction. We merely took the soundtrack and kind of animated to it. And this wasn't a real personality character. This was something quite different and very pleasing. It might look at times like an Indian rug, but it even got laughs. It's a great outlet for your imagination. You take that pencil and put it on the paper, and you can make anything happen.
Ha ha!
Pia, pia.
The big shocker came with Dumbo, early 1940, 39, with that famous Pink Elephants on Parade. And here was a wonderful, imaginative, surrealistic imagery of a nightmare.
Look out, look out, Pink Elephants on Parade.
I know. Many times I have been called an iconoclast. Word has to do things differently. Really, when I analyze it, that was my way of working. Sometimes I had to do it because of sheer boredom. When you animate, it takes so long to do things, and you do things the same way many times. And I kept saying, what's a new approach to this problem? And it had its drawbacks. I made a lot of mistakes. But I made a lot of innovations, don't forget that.
We have stars to guide us, guitars here beside us, to play as we go.
To me, it was a rewarding experience because I got to use my imagination more than I had ever been allowed to use it before.
There was always a rivalry, always a competition. But the genius of Walt in respect to this was the fact that he kept all of these varying personalities working together without killing one another.
Here we are in Walt Disney's attic, where all your favorite Disney personalities live. Ironically, it's called the morgue. But really, it's alive with inspiration. Whenever an animator has a problem developing a character, can't decide on facial expression or a bit of action, you can come here and see how another animator solved a similar problem in the past.
When it came to working on the bear fight and the fox and the hound, I needed some reference on how to approach the dog attacking the bear and the fox attacking the bear. And so I went down to the morgue and checked out a Wooly Reitherman scene from Lady and the Tramp. Wooly Reitherman was an expert in Basque drama action, and this is really what I needed to incorporate into my bear scene in Fox and the Hound.
There was that moment of snarling quiet where the two adversaries were tensing, and you hopefully didn't quite know what was going to happen. And then came the attack, and you always let the bad guys attack first. That gives you a contrast from tension back to action. In a fight, if you drag it out too long, it loses its impact, and the timing is very important.
The thing that really stood out to me was the attitude of Tramp and him having to have to fight his way back to the top. And this was the feeling that I wanted to get in my own animation, where Todd and Copper were fighting the bear.
The fox and the hound will require over 200,000 individual drawings. For the bear fight sequence, about 3 minutes of film, 8,000 drawings have been Xeroxed onto cells that will be hand-painted here in the ink and paint department. Each cell is painted on the reverse side, and every character is assigned a specific color. As you can see, it's meticulous and exacting work. When a sequence is completed in ink and paint, it comes here to the camera department to be photographed. What, all 200,000 of them?
All 200,000, one at a time. Put one down, take a picture of it, take it off, put the next one down, take a picture of it.
Oh, I don't quite get that.
Let me show you with Donald. I'll put Donald down here.
Mm-hmm.
Take a picture of him.
Yes.
Take it off, put the next Donald down, take a picture of him.
But this still doesn't move.
Well, let me put Donald, the next one, down on top of him. Now, you see the difference between their feet?
Yes.
Just a slight bit of difference, but the camera picks that up.
Oh. I still don't understand.
Okay, remember the old flip books that you used to get in the Cracker Jack box?
Yes.
Where you'd flip them and you'd see each individual drawing, it looked like it was moving?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's what we're doing basically. We're taking each one of those pictures individually, and when you see it on the screen, they move.
Oh, I see. Do I?
Yeah.
Thanks, Donald. Now I understand. I think. We still have one more very important step before we're finished. It's called dubbing. This is the process used to add music and sound effects to the picture.
Here's your basic bear fight. It's 50% music, 50% effects. It plays well enough the way it is, but there are different ways to go.
You know, one approach would be to let the dog growls and the bear growls kind of carry the action there. And, you know, try playing the music down just a little bit.
Why can't we play it two ways and then see where we really want to go with it?
Yeah, fine. Okay, we'll do it once with mainly effects, and then we'll go back and we'll do it once mainly with music. And just put the effects in where you actually see something large and commanding on camera.
Okay.
We'll give it to you that way. We'll back it up and do it again.
All right. Sure. Good.
While the studio is completing production on The Fox and the Hound, teams of artists are developing the next project, The Black Cauldron. Before starting the animation for The Black Cauldron, layout artist Don Griffith has to decide how the characters will move within a scene.
Oh, the quick cuts are better art because that'll give you excitement and it'll make the thing move.
He functions like a camera, designing all the different angles, the close-ups and long shots that give the flat, two-dimensional drawings a feeling of depth. Then, background artist Jim Coleman brings these layout drawings to life by creating a world for the characters to inhabit, a place for them to live and move in. By this stage, the story outline has been decided on, and here's where I come in. They're searching for the right voices for the various characters. So before reading for the part of Islandly, I met the men who created her, and they helped me to understand her.
Well, she's a princess, but we think that she has characteristics that are going to make her different from the others that we've done in the past.
And, well, you can see it here on the model.
I can see that they're both the same girl, but it's like they're different aspects of the same girl.
Yes, Ellen has a very spunky quality.
But at the same time, she's very charming and very appealing.
And she seems very sure of herself, too.
Oh, yes.
I mean, she seems quite cross, as if she's ticking him off.
That's right, right.
So, Islandwy and Terran come from very, very different backgrounds. She's a princess, and he's a farm boy.
He's an assistant pig keeper to this little character right here, little Henwen.
Oh, he's absolutely enchanting. Now, who does he remind me of? Me.
That's good, no, because she's a girl.
That wasn't the role we had in mind.
Animation is a continuing process. The young artists of today can draw from the wealth of past experience and bring their own contributions to new projects, like the Black Cauldron. Although Walt Disney didn't invent animation, he and his artists elevated it to a level unparalleled in the world of film. Today, dedicated young artists ensure that the rich legacy that he left will continue to enchant and entertain us. I'll never forget that tour Walt took me on 21 years ago, and the twinkle in his eye when he told me that the only limit to animation is your imagination. After all, he said, how else can you see an elephant fly?
I'd be there.